in your closing statement on behalf of the state of Mississippi, Mr. Sanders.
I see, gentlemen.
Yes, sir, you may.
Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I want to first attack this elephant in the room, all right? I personally have no animosity towards Mr. Robinson. Neither does the Mississippi Attorney General. As a matter of fact, we prosecute cases for Robert Smith on a regular basis. We have, by statute, the right to ask that every case we try for him be paid for out of his salary, directly from his paycheck. Never once did Attorney General Jim Hood say, let's go do that. If we were to take money out of his check for every case we prosecute for him, he would not get a paycheck. That's how much work we do for the highest county district attorney's office. For them to get up here and say that there's some animosity or some vendetta that the AG's office has against Mr. Smith is not proven. They have not put any evidence to support that. So let's just deal with that on the front end. Now, you know, I used to talk about, you know, those cases in California. They last 3 weeks, 4 weeks, a month. How do you get a case to last 3 or 4 weeks? I learned a lesson. This is the longest case I've ever tried, no matter what. But the fact of the matter is, most of the stuff that caused this case to last so long came from the defense. The state focused on our case in chief. The defense brought out a whole bunch of other stuff. Tracy Chandler. All of this stuff about Mr. Smith taking bribes. All that came from the defendant. They opened the door on all of that stuff. Remember that, Mr. Smith, in response to Ronnie Oldham's testimony, the only thing he asked about, right? If y'all remember Mr. Oldham's testimony, we went through each count of the indictment. And for each count, Mr. Oldham gave information about how the state is showing that we proved that particular count. Mr. Smith cross-examined Mr. Oldham and didn't ask him one question about the evidence that the state has proved. He introduced Tracy Chandler, which was basically evidence that somebody was saying he took bribes. That doesn't help him, and it doesn't repeat what the state has proved. Now, we'll deal with count one of the indictment. I think the court read you some jury instructions, told you what the state has proved. And from the indictment, the state has to show that Mr. Smith acted in conspiracy with Ivan Johnson, Jimmy McBride, and others. And you've seen plenty of testimony to support that Mr. Smith, as well as Mr. McBride, as well as Mr. Johnson, and other people in his office, were all working together to find evidence to get Mr. Butler released. We have testimony from Mr. Smith and Mr. Johnson talking. And basically what the goal of the grand jury that they've been trying to do, pressure Judge Will to get Butler free. And count one of the indictment, this deals with the Butler drug charges and what Mr. Smith did to preclude the prosecution of Butler in other cases. Now, remember when the defense counsel first did their open statement, their theory of defense was, we're going to show that there was drugs planted at Christopher Butler's house, and the district attorney was doing what he needed to do because the MBN had done all this illegal activity to show that there was drugs planted. Have either of you seen any evidence that the drugs were planted? Mr. Smith asked the DVD player in which the video that Jamie McBride said he needed to see infinite amount of, you know, time. He needed to see back to the camera from first installed in the house to determine who put the drugs there, which is completely, you know, above and beyond what any prosecutor does in a particular case. You know, Mr. Smith has that camera. He has that video. Did he show you any of that camera footage? Did he show it to you? He had every opportunity to. You know why he didn't? Because it's not going to show MBN or NCI planning drugs in Mr. Christopher Butler's house. That's just a lie. He didn't have it. And what did Gail Walker tell you yesterday? In 2013 August, you got a text message from Robert Smith talking about the Crystal Buck case. Wayne went to review the tape with Shannon. 2013, although Mr. Smith wants you to believe that they never had a chance to see the video, 2013, he is sending a text message about his ADA and his investigator who have reviewed the video. So when he tells Judge Will that the video's been tampered with and that there's no evidence to support the case, that's just not true. They saw the video and then they indicted the case. Remember that, 2013. And just for good measure, just so we know what he's talking about, I need to talk to you about Crystal Buck. 2013. Robert Smith. There's no doubt about it, he knew that there was no evidence of any tampering with that video in 2013. And what did Gail tell you? He had harassed me so much about that case. He had harassed me to the point where I threw my hands up and said, you go do it, I'm not gonna do it. And what happened as a result, according to her, she got fired. Now once she get fired, somebody had, three people had access to a check system in the DA's office. That was in the district attorney's office. Three people, Mr. Smith, Ms. Parker, and some other lady. And what happened when she said, I wanted to bring the FBI in. The DA says, I want the FBI in my office. You go get MBI, right? And what she tell you, once MBI got to a point where they could figure out who actually did it, now y'all gonna get out of my office. Why would he want that investigation to go forward if she's lying about it? Now, we know the state has proved that there was some dishonesty or something attempt to mislead the court. We're going to deal with count one of that right now. So what we have is the transcript from Judge Wilson, January 22nd, 2015. Mr. Smith, after reviewing the entire case, we found exculpatory evidence. That's a lot. You heard Gail Walker say that they were ready to move forward and try the case. You saw the text message between Shannon and Wayne. They had reviewed the evidence. There was no indication that there was any exculpatory evidence that was not presented to the district attorney's office. That's just not true. What he told Judge Will. That is a false and misleading statement. That is the very definition of what Mr. Smith is charged with. We know that that was not a true statement. What else did he say? Based on expert, we found evidence of tampering. Where is the evidence of tampering? Did y'all see any of it? Although Jamie McBride did, you know, he has every reason to, you know, get up there and try to make it look something like something different because he still works for Mr. Smith. He wants to make sure he keeps his job. Y'all know what happens to people who don't go along with Mr. Smith's sales, right? That's Michael Henry. He got fired because he wouldn't sign an affidavit saying to Mr. McBride. What did Mr. McBride tell the FBI? I would love to help y'all, but I might get fired. And what did he tell you on the stand? Am I still worried about my job? Yes, I am. So of course he's gonna get up there. He ain't gonna try to do anything to make his boss look bad. But he didn't help because it didn't make sense what he was saying. Y'all heard him. The judge had to admonish him several times. Answer the question, Mr. McBride. Answer the question. Where is the evidence that found him, Mr. Cameron? That's a lie. That is the very definition of what Mr. Smith is charged with, providing misleading information to a court in order to get Crystal Buck off. The whole purpose of this hearing was for the law process, to get Judge Will to dismiss the case. Right? So he's lying in order to get Judge Will to dismiss the case. That's what the state has to prove. We won't stop there. Based on expert testimony. No expert testimony. Not a scrap of it. Several discovery violations. What violations? Discovery. You heard from Sanford Knott, who was Crystal Public's attorney. You heard from Kevin Rutherford, who was Crystal Public's attorney. Neither one of them said that there was any discovery knowledge. They both said that they wanted to see the video. Neither one of them said there was a discovery knowledge. Mr. Smith says all that. And remember, also the question Mr. Anderson asked Mr. Rutherford, have you ever said that drugs were planted in that house? No. You heard me again, and he said, they talked to Crystal Buck. Crystal Buck said, the drugs are mine, don't mess with my girlfriend. Your girlfriend said, and you saw her, of course she got up there, tried to make it up as she went along with it. Unfortunately for her, she had given a written statement and signed it. The drugs in the house belong to Chris. Never once did she say, I don't know who the drugs belong to, they were planted. The only person who's told anybody that the drugs were planted in that house, Robert Smith. Robert Smith. That is a false and misleading statement. That is what he's charged with. We don't have to prove that he completed any act. All we gotta do is show that his intent was to get Christian Butler off. We know that. And we have to show that he provided false, misleading statements in order to do that. This is the first page of this document. And there's at least three or four instances where he provided false and misleading statements to the court in order to get Crystal Butler off. He lied about, and I apologize. People don't appreciate that word lies, and some people don't like it here. But I'm a straightforward type of person. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It's one thing if you make a mistake. It's another thing if you know the truth and you say something completely different. That is a lie, by very definition of it. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. He said, that is what is alleged that marijuana was found. Alleged that marijuana was found. We know for a fact marijuana was found in the house. There's no allegation. Yes, it is. That's what the state charged Mr. Smith with. The evidence is clear. He is not being honest with that court, and he's making up as he goes along. Now, I'm sorry. The second search, I believe it was around the same amount. About a pound? Yes, sir. That's two more misleading statements, false or misleading statements against the court. Now, well, we can have a written report from an expert concerning the allegations of tampering. We have testimony, yes, sir. Do you have a written report from your expert? I do not have a written report. I can get one. Where's the written report? Everyone wants that they get a written report. And you heard Mr. McBride suggest Redford, or whoever, Turner, Travis Turner, was the guy who's supposed to be this expert. Mr. McBride tells you, he never was able to get a report from Mr. Turner about any evidence of tampering with that video. This being statements to the court. And that's what he's been charged with in count one. As to count two of the indictment. Now we go to his hindering the prosecution of Mr. Butler for the White House crimes. Now, first and foremost, y'all have all heard the statutes. Statute that clearly says the Mississippi Attorney General's office shall prosecute white collar crimes. Shall. It's not a may, it's not a might. Shall, when they write that language into a statute, that means we must do it. And then we can ask for the assistance of a district attorney or his associates. Not the DA's office can prosecute white collar crimes and then the AG's office got to ask his permission. Mr. Smith is an attorney. He's a criminal prosecutor. He should know how to read the statute and interpret it. It's clear. I think you've all heard it, and it's pretty clear to you. So why is he involving himself in Christian public case in the first place? In that white collar crime. One is, we have to show that he provided false and misleading statements in the attempt to get Chris Butler off in count two. Well, I'll take you to the hearing before Judge Will. I'm sorry, Judge Priester, on March 3rd, 2016. This is the district attorney interrupting the preliminary hearing for Christopher Butler. Now, mind you, he went down to Christopher Butler's defense attorney to argue that the Mississippi Attorney General's office should not prosecute Christopher Butler. Why? Why is he involved in that case in the first place? He has no authority, no jurisdiction over that particular case. And what does he tell the judge? That these two gentlemen from the district, they work in the district attorney's office and they know about Christopher Butler. Mr. Beasley told you he hadn't heard about Christopher Butler until an agent told him that somebody named Chris was doing something that never matters. He didn't know Christopher Butler before that. So that's a misleading and false statement that he told to the court. It's just not true. Then he says that the video, which was shown that Mr. Butler was framed twice, and they know that. Did y'all see any video that showed Mr. Buck was framed twice? As a matter of fact, the judge, Priester, caught him in that misstatement himself. What did he say? I personally take interest. I personally take issue with that. I personally take issue with what you just told me, Mr. Smith. It's not true, because I watched the video, and there is no evidence to support that. That's what you've been charged with, ladies and gentlemen, providing false, misleading statements to a court in order to get Christopher Butler off. And then he changes it. Well, I have an expert who corroborates the fact that the video was tampered. He changed it within 2 minutes. Changed the whole story. What would the judge tell him? Well, that's a little different than what you said. Did you provide a false and misleading statement to the court and the judge had to call upon himself? Yes, he did. And then he tells you, well, you all know, you heard evidence about this grand jury and why, you know, you wanted to take Judge Will and Patrick Sean McCurran to the grand jury. And once the order was delivered to me around 5 o'clock, Mr. Butler then gets arrested, knowing that the subject matter of the testimony was about Christopher Butler's indictment, and they know that. The subject matter of their testimony for which you had this opinion for a grand jury was about Christopher Butler. Do you think that he's trying to intimidate the prosecutors by trying to take them to a grand jury to talk about why they're prosecuting his friend Christopher Butler? What's the purpose, if not to attempt to harass these individuals, put them in a posture where they feel threatened with their livelihood? Because these are professionals. These are attorneys. And if you take them to a grand jury and you get them indicted, that is a smudge on their character as well as their professional abilities in the future. You've been indicted by a grand jury. You know, what does that look like to a prosecutor? Why would he do that? It doesn't matter why he did it. The fact of the matter is he did it. And that goes to show that he was attempting to intimidate these individuals to avoid the prosecution of Christopher Butler. That's what he's charged with in count two. Sean and Patrick had nothing to do with the drug charges. Sean and Patrick had nothing to do with that. Everything that he did to them was about count two, the wire fraud, white collar crime case. And you'll have access to all of these emails where you see Mr. Smith and Mr. Johnson talking about the possible charges against Jane. I'm sorry, against, you know, counsel, Hosberger, perjury, conspiracy. I've been in this case for 40 years, and all that Jamie talking about, he ain't trying to hear. So he wasn't even trying to hear people who had a different opinion about what he thought. He gonna move forward whatever he wants to do regardless. You also have this. Well, basically, Harvard wants to review a portion of the video and just give him his opinion. Portions only 10 minutes old. He hasn't seen the video, ladies and gentlemen. He hasn't seen the video until 2016 himself. And he's in every court talking about the video with the tamper with. How do you know that? The only person who told him that there may be some tampering with the video has been a defendant and his defense counsel. His lawyers, the people who he paid to review his cases in 2013, said that there was evidence to move forward. So you take the word of the criminal defendant and the criminal defense counsel over the attorneys that you hire to come to your court to prosecute for. Disregard what they say. But the fact of the matter is, he didn't care what they said. He doesn't care. I don't give a damn about there not being charges. I don't care. I'm going to find something. Why is he fighting so hard for Christopher Butler? Why? I'm not expecting y'all to agree with me if it's legally not there. He understands it's not even legal. But he's still going to push forward. He still attempted to have these four counts of obstruction of justice against Judge Will and conspiracy counts against Will and Sean and Patrick for filing false charges. What false charges is he talking about? The white collar crime? The Magna Matrix scam that Christopher Butler was running? Is he concerned about the people who Christopher Butler took advantage of? The people who got these bills from the company that Magna Matrix
that McNamara took there, Longstreet, the citizens of Hines County who had to get a notice in that your bill hasn't been paid, even though you never got approved for any credit. Did he fight for those people at all? Was he concerned about those people? No. He was more concerned about Sean and Patrick filing false charges. What's the evidence that they're false? What's the evidence of it?
25 minutes, Count.
Thank you. You got messages to the news media. Have a hot topic. Christopher Butler. Everything he does, for some reason, he's trying to get Christopher Butler. We're going to move on to Count 3 since we're kind of running out of time. Now, Count 3, we have to show that he provided criminal assistance. You saw that Mr. Smith went to the jails at least once or twice. You saw Sam will not tell you that I didn't give him permission to talk about anything but anything about his case, Christopher Butler. For some reason, the letters, of course, are not in evidence, but you have an affidavit on police officer letterhead that Mr. Smith admits he had Christopher Butler write. You have a letter to the media and Mr. Stokes, y'all heard him testify yesterday, that Mr. Smith admits he had him write. And then what does he do? He tries to use those two letters that he had Christopher Butler write as a basis to take two prosecutors to the grand jury. He has the audacity to say that there's been some kind of prosecutorial misconduct. That's the very definition. It's just like if a police officer takes a pound of weed and puts it in your house, then comes and arrests you and charges you with possessing that marijuana. He created the crime and then he attempted to charge you with it. There's no evidence from anyone that Sean or Patrick or anybody else threatened Christopher Butler. What we do know is he wrote a letter to Sanford Knott explaining how to attack the state of Mississippi's case against Christopher Butler. That is providing assistance to a criminal defendant. We know for a fact he went to the jail twice and had Christopher Butler write letters proclaiming his innocence and threat. That is providing material assistance to a criminal defendant. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Smith does not care who he destroys in his attempt to get Christopher Butler off. Yet, Jamie Patrick, who ended up getting indicted because he was trying to help his boss do something that wasn't kosher. You had Sean and Patrick, who were prosecutors, who he attempted to take to a grand jury. You had Judge Will, who he attempted to take to a grand jury. You had Michael Henry, heard testimony by him, who would not sign a false affidavit for him, and he got fired to get Christopher Butler, help Christopher Butler. And last but not least, you had Gail Warren, who told you that not only would she not do what he wanted him to do, he harassed her, he brought up information that could not have been brought up by anybody else, scratched her name out on a name tag outside, and ultimately fired her. Because she would not help him get rid of Christopher Butler's case. He didn't care who he destroyed. How many fine, upstanding individuals have he thrown under the bus to help a career criminal? It's not like Christopher Butler's a first-time major offender. He's a habitual offender. He saw evidence that he had pounds of weed and money in his house, cocaine in his house. And then, not only did he do that, while he's out on bond, scams, I don't know how many people. How many people got scammed by Christopher Butler?
You got to 1 minute.
Mr. Smith fighting for him at the expense of everybody else. I think the state has shown that Mr. Smith provided false information and provided material assistance to criminal defendant Christopher Butler, and we're going to ask that you find him guilty on all counts. Thank you.
All right, defense counsel, Mr. Wade, you have an opportunity. I give you 5-minute notice on expiration, please.
May I please approach?
Yes, sir. I know y'all have gone through a lot to listen to all this, about to find your time. But it's a very important case because it's about whether an ordinary person, even a person that's charged with serious crimes and has a criminal history, has a right to have his situation looked into. Or whether, as prosecutors say, just because the gentleman of the House is one of the certain judges, still under our system, Attorney General, whether they are entitled to special treatment, and whether we're going to go all out about a district attorney to try to look into whether they've been guilty of any misconduct. Quite true to that. I listen with disbelief as the prosecutor told you there's no animosity between the Attorney General, the Attorney General's office, and District Attorney Speaker. He said that after he heard the testimony that he had himself been an attempted fistfight with Mr. Speaker. He said that after Mr. Alexander had run a bitter political campaign against Mr. Smith, in which one of his campaign workers had made these false charges Robert had been drinking or using marijuana. He made that claim in face of the fact that he had the preliminary hearing before Judge Priester, where they get into this debate over who has the authority of a particular case. He made that after. Now listen to this. Think about Jamie McBride just a minute. There was no intent to do anything to Jamie McBride until he signed an affidavit for Robert Smith, and then he gets indicted. And it was not us that brought up Henderson up here. I have never seen such witness that this fellow is a psychopath. He actually said that he took money from three different criminal defendants. And he didn't see anything wrong with that. The only thing he saw wrong with it was Mr. Smith wouldn't dismiss the charges. He's a psychopath. And who interviewed him? Stanley Alexander. What do you think they promised him to get him to say this? Come up here and say this. I want to show you a little bit of the evidence in the case. And I know there's so many documents that it's hard to look at them, so I want to point out just a few of the things that I think are important to you that I hope that you will take a look at. I guess before I do it, I need to tell you this. Count 1 and 2 deal with a conspiracy with Jamie McBride. Conspiracy and agreement with Jamie McBride. Now, let me ask you, if he's guilty, then Jamie McBride's guilty, right? How can it be a conspiracy with Jamie McBride? They indict Jamie McBride on the first day of the trial, dismiss the charge by Jamie. They just dismiss it. They had two reasons to indict Jamie McBride. One, he gave that affidavit they didn't like. And second, they thought they could make the same type of deal with him they do with others. And if you testify against Robert, tell us something bad against Robert, and you'll get off. There's no other reason for doing that. Now, you talk about obstruction of justice. That is obstruction of justice. Isn't it? I mean, that's why I put it though. Let me show you a little bit of the evidence that I think is important that we emphasize.
You remember, Mr.
court ruled that we could not introduce the statement that Butler gave. You also remember that Butler's attorneys had taken the Fifth Amendment. Y'all remember? When we tried to question, we brought Mr. Butler here and we tried to question. His attorney had to make the Fifth Amendment. So he didn't testify. I'll try to talk to you about why they were doing that. We have time. But we do have some of the things that were said. It was in the June transcript. This is the second transcript that's in evidence. It's, I don't have the exhibit number, but it's a June transcript between Johnson and Mr. Smith. And they have a statement out that Christopher had written. This is actually the two statements. This is the May 9th when Robert went to the jail that he's showing Johnson. Johnson's acting as government informant. He doesn't know it. Here's what Mr. Smith was telling Johnson. He didn't know Johnson's taking him and trying to set him up with some crime. Not knowing he's been taken. And Mr. Smith tells Johnson. Well, Johnson says, so Christopher Parker wrote this. He's referring to the May 9th statement. Or affidavit. Smith, He actually wrote it to several people. Get his stuff to lay it over the radio. And then I got on it, and he's been on the radio.